decided to do that on what turned out to be a wonderful warm fall evening. I was hoping my allergies would have passed by now with some nice cool weather, but that's not the case, so I may have to stop occasionally tonight to catch my breath. I do work for the Wisconsin Historical Society. We are a state agency and a membership organization with 12,000 members statewide. For the last 170 years, we have worked with Wisconsin citizens to collect Wisconsin stories in Wisconsin history. We've worked with them to help preserve that and make sure it's available for the next generation, and then make it available for the public in as many different ways as we can figure out. As you might expect, the information that's come to us, it comes to us today, is much different than it was 170 years ago. A lot of electronic information, a lot of emails, and the way we present that information to the public has changed radically. We now currently have over a half a million pages of original historic materials online, so that anybody in the state who has access to the internet can look at it. We still have the State Historical Society Museum that gets about 70,000 visitors each year. Still maintain an area research network where local folks can order materials from our library and archives and have them delivered locally. We still have 10 historic sites that we take tens of thousands of people each year. And we still work very actively with residents all across the state to preserve historic places, whether it's an old building downtown that's being rehabilitated, or whether it's a 12,000-year-old archaeological site. So one thing where we always remind ourselves of is that most of Wisconsin's history is in private hands and in private property, and so we look forward to working with those folks to preserve that information. In 1987, when the federal government passed the Abandoned Shipwreck Act, Wisconsin established a maritime archaeology and maritime history program to make sure that Wisconsin shipwrecks and other underwater historic sites were documented, protected, and that that information was made publicly available. Over that 30 years, we think our program has been very successful. It's been very successful for the following reasons: that we have a very active program to go out and document wrecks on a regular basis and make that information publicly accessible. We have a long history of embracing new technology. Now, I know this is going to sound silly at this point, but we were the first program at the Wisconsin Historical Society to have a website. We just finished a project where we took some underwater photographs and turned those into scalable, measurable lines, and we think that's going to be applicable to a wide variety of folks who work underwater, but also on land. We've had a very aggressive and a very progressive public outreach program. This deals not only with public education, but in 2000 or 2001, I forget, we invented Wisconsin's Maritime Trails. This trail lines above and below the waves. It connects shipwrecks, other docks, historic structures, downtowns, charter boat operators who cater to taking people out on the lake, kayakers. It links local museums, maritime theme parks. We joke at maritime trails that you can dive it, kayak it, boat it, drive it, bike it, walk it, or you can just sit home in the comfort of your living room and circle down the road. What we think has made our program particularly successful over this period of time is that we have developed partnerships with literally dozens of organizations. We really recently sat down and reviewed and put together a list of those partnerships over the last couple of years. It was 4.5 pages of single sentence. So that's typical of our program, that's typical of the Wisconsin Historical Society. One thing that we've learned over the last 30 years with our maritime program, and when we talk about it, is that Wisconsin's maritime history and shipwrecks is extremely popular. Now, you know, you would expect that we gave a program here on the lake that we would get a room full of people. But we get room overflow crowds wherever we go. Inland, on the lakes, we do programs in Wisconsin Central Sands area, we get room crowds full of them. What we've also discovered is that shipwrecks are particularly fascinating to young people. We can go into a classroom of disgruntled eighth graders or high school students, and by the end of it, they're fascinated by it. We don't expect all of them to become maritime archaeologists or maritime historians, but what we do think it does is we think it introduces them to the lakes, the importance of the lakes in Wisconsin's history, but perhaps more importantly, it's a great way to talk about the role that the lakes play in the economy of Wisconsin today and in all of your communities. We think having the National Marine Sanctuary staff in Wisconsin is a great thing because they have technologies that we don't have access to and we will not have access to. This last summer they had a boat in the area that was doing some bottom land mapping and looking for shipwrecks as part of that. We have never done that in our program. We simply don't have the technology to look for wrecks. We don't have the staff. But really, that type of information is really critically to managing these historic places and talking about them. We think having sanctuary staff here will give us access not to just that type of technology, but other type of public outreach technology, and to NOAA staff across the U.S. so that we can bring programming from the West Coast or the East Coast or the Florida Keys into classrooms in Wisconsin and into local communities. In addition to that, we think establishing this sanctuary will give all of you and all of the communities along the coast here the opportunity to talk about all of the great things you're doing and all of the things that your communities can offer on a national level. One other thing we've learned over the years is that if you want to be effective in public outreach, particularly in public education, really need to have some people on site and in those communities on a regular basis. So we think having a sanctuary staff in this area will really give us and give students here an opportunity to work with scientists across the U.S. I'll be honest with you, we're looking at this too, for the opportunity is that we're going to be able to redirect some of our energies to other places in Wisconsin. We are, after all, a statewide program, and so there are some things we'd like to do on the inland lakes and rivers. That does not mean we're going to abandon this section of the Great Lakes to the NOAA sanctuary staff. We are dedicated to co-managing this with them. Russ doesn't know this yet, but we've got lots of great projects that he's going to help us on. We're looking forward to working with him on that. We think it's going to give us a great opportunity also to work with all the people that we've met through this process. We started doing programs with the Port Explorium and Port Washington. We're going to look forward to working with the spaceport here in Sheboygan on a more regular basis. So we think this is going to be a great opportunity. When we learned about the possibility that the Marine Sanctuary program might expand in 2006, we really felt we had an obligation to look into that and to investigate it and to see if there was some spot in Wisconsin that was nationally significant and if the program was something that fit for us. And so we did that background research. We think we have an area that's, we know we have an area that's nationally significant. And based upon that, we went out and started to talk to people about this program and what we thought it might do and how we thought it might benefit us and NOAA. And that really resulted in the nomination that was sent to the sanctuary program in December of 2014. So we've been involved in this from the beginning. I don't know how many people and how many organizations we've talked to since 2007 about this, so we really haven't kept track, but we've been in this area and talking to people on a regular basis throughout that time period. So look forward to the comments of the other folks on the panel tonight as we move to your questions.